Please receive the second worksheet. Will work now. She can experience very nicely and explain to you guys. So I'll sit here and let her explain. Because I was so strong from the beginning in my consciousness, I never allowed anybody to put me in guilt. I only put them in guilt.
So the next two papers that you got just now is from guilt. As I was sharing yesterday, we are going layer by layer, that those spaces which happen at the time, at the time called death, when something inside the body is leaving the body, it goes through each layer, and we are doing each layer one by one. So we covered death, right? We covered first fear and fear of death. Then we did desire. Did you all do desire? We did desire, no? Today morning we started with desire. Then of course we did pain yesterday. Now we are doing guilt. Each of these emotions, each of these memories, each of these patterns have a very strong impact and influence on the way the quality of your life will go, and obviously the way the quality of your death will be. So that is why cleansing each of this actually ensures not just about the dying process, but also of course about what happens through as you're living. Every moment of life is transformed just with your deepening of your understanding into each of these and cleansing these layers. Clear? Yes. So guilt is related to the mental layer. It's related to the layer which is related to the mind. Before we go into writing, all of these is what you gathered as you started growing in your life. Sonu ji, aapko baithna padega. All of these is what you gathered when you started growing up in your life. You know, when we were born, the other day we were speaking about the past, present, future, remember? As we were born, when we were born, nothing was there. Was there any guilt? Was there any fear? Was there any greed? There was nothing for you and me. We were just a pure space of energy happening. Maybe probably till a few months old or a year old, or for some of us 2 years old, right? Till what happened in us? Till language started happening in us. Isn't it? That's what we saw. That when the language begins, the ability to comprehend, the cognition starts when the words begin, when the language begins. That only is what we also call as the mind. Your thinking faculty, applying that and responding to life happens when language happens. Now, as language is happening and as life is moving, there are moments when suddenly and in some vulnerable point in time, when you were not ready or prepared, or you didn't know why it happened the way it happened, you know, there was a point which hits you, which kind of becomes that moment where you say something is wrong here. Yesterday somebody was saying, na, when I asked, what do you think the child would say? It's playing, and suddenly somebody says, just shut up, go and sit there, like that. Suddenly for the first time you're shouted at, or apparently somebody is raising their voice on you. Then one of us said, who said? Somebody said, you will think that, oh God, something is wrong here. And that's exactly, there comes a point in time when we think that something is wrong with me, or something is wrong with life, something is really not right. And that's the phase typically when language has already begun in you. So you will define that as something not so good is happening. Do you get this? And that becomes the fundamental basis of many things in your life which you will start defining as bad, which you will start defining as not so right. Are we getting this? As human beings, our existence is inside of a very fixed net. You know, it's like a fence inside of which I live my life. What are the corners of that fence? What do you think is there that binds me? What is that fence? Not in terms of the emotions. Those are all emotions, right? Fear, greed. But all of that is inside a racket, is inside a fence, a boundary that's fenced around me, and that is what I am bound by the way. You know what they are? They are these so-called, you know, stoppers that's there in you in terms of language. Is this good? Is this bad? Is this right? Is this wrong? How do I benefit out of this? Why is she talking like this? Who is he? You know, it is like a never-ending loop of judgments that are there in you any moment in life. If you see anything, if you're living life, you never have a pure listening to life. This is the filter inside of which you're receiving life. Is this in this class we spoke about the filters? We spoke about it. Okay. So it's basically like this. If you have a tea, you know the process of making tea? When you pour the tea, you use a filter, right? And it filters out, isn't it? And what the leaves and all that is left on the filter. In life also, we have filters. Filters inside of which life gets into you. Means what is happening on the surface, what is there in the filter? Lot of life is getting filtered out. You actually miss life in the process of using that filter and receiving life. And the filters that we insert inside ourselves is all these things. Something is not right here. What do I get if I do this? Is he right? Is he wrong? This is how it should be. This is not how it should not be. I don't agree with this. I think he has some vested interest in this. You know, that continuous chatter, the inner chatter that we call, is on. And it is continuously, not just randomly on. It's not that, you know, it just says something and keeps quiet. It very, very strongly has its hold on you, telling you each moment, this is right, this is wrong, this is how it should be, this is not how it should be, I don't agree with this, I disagree with this. All these things. And those are the filters that are inserted inside you and me through which we receive life. So what we'll do, especially in the aspect of guilt, we'll go and look at what are all the various instances, points in life where we kind of got into an experience of guilt. That is what the whole guilt process is about. Are we getting this? At one level, we have guilts related to our own bodies. You know, sex, as we understand it in the society, is a big taboo. In so many societies, they don't discuss about it openly. It's actually looking at it like a taboo and not discussing and hiding it itself is a big abuse. And inside of that, what happens is the next generation thinks that it is something they should not be talking openly, and they talk behind the curtain, and you know, all the abuses, all the perversions that exist in the area and field of sex are a direct proportionate to the unconscious behavior of human beings. Otherwise, if you see, from a pure conscious awareness perspective, sex is nothing but an energy. Yes or no? It's just an energy that's available like so many other energies that are there. Isn't it? Talking is an energy. But you don't refrain from talking. You talk all the time. Sex is also an energy like that. It's a natural energy available in this miracle called your body. But unfortunately, because of the unawareness and unconscious society, sex becomes a big, huge, you know, tool for people to get, unfortunately, for people to get more unconscious, for the younger generation to get misled, and to result in so many ways, crime, abuse, so much is related around sex. So on the first sheet, you will be actually looking at those aspects of your life. So much of your guilt, emotion and experience is related to sex. You know, whether it is engaging in yourself as an existence, the gender that you are, or engaging in the same gender that is there for you, in the other person who's also the same gender, or engaging in the opposite gender, because of the unconsciousness that's there around you when you were growing up, you had no choice. By default, you went into guilt related to the whole aspect of sex. So the first sheet will actually speak about that. The guilts that we picked up based on this whole energy called sex, based on our gender. That's the first sheet. The second sheet is about mentally how you accumulated guilt. The first sheet is physical guilts in a way. You know, physically so many of us hate our bodies. We hate another's body and so many things around it. The second sheet is more of a mental process. Mentally how I got into the guilt pattern, as I was sharing, between ages, let's say 1 and 6 or 3 to 6, the very early childhood, there have been incidents in your life where you were not prepared, One fine sudden day something happens and you just got into the guilt, oh God, something is wrong here. Something is wrong with me. Because for a child who's 3, who's 4, who's 5, there is no life and there is no me separately. For a child, life and me is the same. So when something wrong is going out there, the child instantly understands, oh, I am wrong. Something is wrong with me. Do you get this? So if there is a child whose parents are fighting in the house, beating each other, the child will just think, something is wrong with me that this is happening, you know, like that. And that's a very strong guilt the child begins carrying inside. So this second sheet is going, you know, again into those different age groups inside which we acquired so many guilts. One is the very early childhood where when something happened in life, I just got the experience that something is wrong here and I just forever went with that after that. It's like a lens I put on me that something is wrong with life. And from then onwards, you can never actually get into any life situation without this additional lens called something is wrong here. Are you guys getting this? It's like I was running. I was fine till one day. But one day I suddenly thought I broke my leg. It's actually not broken. It's an illusion. It's actually not that something really went wrong, but I perceived it like that. Are you guys getting this? So I thought I broke my leg and what am I doing? Now I take a crutch. You know what is that called? You use it for walking, na? You know, I gather a crutch under my arm because I believe now my leg is broken. And I'm limping with that crutch for the rest of my life. I forget that I even have a crutch because I'm so used to it after some years. But what do you think is happening? The more and more I'm using the crutch, what am I actually telling myself? I'm actually waiting for myself to fall. That's why I need the crutch, isn't it? You understand? The more I'm limping with the crutch, the more I'm acknowledging, oh God, I'm going to fall any minute. Oh God, I'm going to fall any minute. That's why I need this crutch. So the moment you get that, oh, something is wrong here. And that's only a cognition. You just understood it like that. It's not that that's the truth. That's one way you got it, the situation. But from then onwards, the damage that you've done to yourself is, you know what? You're continuously waiting for what to happen in life. Yeah, something wrong to happen in life. Continuously from that day onwards, you're waiting. Oh, something is surely, I think now it's going to go wrong. Like that. You're a constant, something is wrong here, waiting to happen. And you're running with that. Now you've become a teenager. Let's say like 11, 12. What is teen? 13. 13 to whatever, the typical 22, you know, 21, teen. That teen age. In teenage, what is the only thing teenagers really want? Do we have teenagers in this room? So typically, what is it that teenagers deal with? They deal with a sense of acceptance because they are going through certain confusions, both in the way they see the society as they're growing, the way they see their own body. You know, everything is transitioning so fast for them. And what they're continuously waiting for is clarity, number one. And number two, a certain sense of acceptance. And during teenage, typically there are situations that life hits at you where you somewhere come into the conclusion, I don't belong anymore to this place. You know, that I don't belong is the second crutch you wear. And now you're running with two. One is something is wrong here, one is I don't belong. From then onwards, your whole life is waiting for both to happen. I don't belong can be in any form. Something happened in your family, your mom or dad said something and you say, I don't belong to this family anymore. Or something happened in your
please
college.
Please listen here. Two of you, please sit up when she's talking and look here and listen. Okay, all right.
So, or it could be some group, you know, maybe a football club or maybe your college. Or maybe just the group of boys in your class where you just some incident kind of displaces you and you say, I don't belong to this anymore. Repulsion or an attraction to a particular way of living because of this feeling that I don't belong to somewhere. I don't belong to this group. I don't belong to this place. Are you guys getting what I'm saying? How many of us had these experiences? I don't belong to anything, either mother, father, school. Every single hand in the room should go up. Because all of us, this is a default design. All human beings get into this. We may not be aware, but all of us, in some form or the other, have to go through the experience, I don't belong, at least once in life. And from then onwards, life is about something is wrong here and I also don't belong to happen. Now you are running with these two crutches. Now comes the next phase of your life, and that is what? One is childhood, one is teenage, and the next is adulthood. The early adulthood, when you just begin to mature into an adult. You know, typically the age 20 to let's say 26, 25, 24, depends upon, you know, different cultures the age will vary, but around that age group. And that is the time when once you are actually propelled into a life which is now coming to a full stop. As I told you, we stop living after a certain stage. There's so much of past which is accumulated into the future. You're continuously going into the future, which is nothing but what? A repetition of the past. So there's no future anymore. Means there's no living life as it is happening now. It is living life which happened 10 years back. Again living life that. Again living another life tomorrow morning which has happened already 10 years back. Like that. 5 years back. Like that. Are we getting this? So once I get into adulthood, again there are situations around me where I get into this conclusion. Each conclusion is like a life sentence. It's like a death sentence I've given to myself. You know the death life sentences that is given at court? For the rest of your life, can you run away? Of course, if you run away from it, when you escape from the jail, it's different. Otherwise, by default, can you do anything about it? You have to live it. You understand? So this is like the third life sentence you give to yourself, which is where you feel, oh, I'm all alone. There's nobody, there's no hope for me anymore in this world. I am all alone. So now what are you, by the way? You may actually physically be 22 years old. That's all. There's no life after that. Even at the age 60, you're only these three happening. What are the three happening? Continuously you're waiting for something is wrong here to happen. I don't belong to happen, or I'm all alone to happen. One of the other will keep continuing happening as an experience. Are you getting this? Are you understanding what I'm saying? And that's it. That's the limitation that exists in most of our lives. That's why you will see, no matter how much money you have, no matter how many good jewelry and clothes and bigger cars, more number of cars, shoes and this and that and, you know, relations and so much you have outside, what's happening inside? Total bankruptcy. A stark, harsh, unfortunate, extreme. Isn't it? Outwardly what's happening, inwardly is completely different.